was 1970, the glam rock era and the beginning of Sherbet. Sherbet had it all. Great musicians who wrote memorable and well-written songs and a brilliant lead singer. Have you been doing this for 50 years?
We started in Sherbet 1970.
Yeah, that's 50 years.
That's 50, isn't it? Yes.
Maths is never a strong point for anyone in the arts.
No.
But that sounds 50. Yeah, that's
it. Yeah, that'll do.
My God. When you bring your love into me. Sherbet toured relentlessly. They were known as one of the hardest working bands on the local music scene. And even when you first started, weren't you doing 7-hour sets at a nightclub in Sydney?
Yeah, no, well, I think like any bands, I don't know if they do it now, but you'd do 3 or 4 sets a night of 45, 50 minutes. And we were smoking back then as well.
Yeah, that's always good.
Oh, you know. Roger, our manager, used to always say, exposure never hurt you. He gave us a good grounding. Ted Mulry did it, Dragon, John Paul Young. That's all we lived and breathed for, you know, was being on the road. And around Australia in 80 days was such a good tour, I think, to promote the How's That album.
Sherbet's manager, Roger Davies, was the one to suggest they record How's That. Not only did it top the Aussie chart, it entered the US Billboard Hot 100 and reached number 4 on the UK music charts. Sherbet was voted Best Australian Group for 5 years in a row, and Daryl was named King of Pop for 3 years running. You look at the things that were done for publicity back in the day. There's a very famous photo where there seemed to be a bit of a strain on the wardrobe budget. And so you all posed nude.
Oh, is that the Lewis Morley? The Lewis Morley photo. That thing of unity, being in a group, the chemistry. If it works, you know, hang on to it because it makes a difference. We've been there for about 8 hours and we got into the end of our tether. And you and Lewis Morley standing up the back going, maybe they should get in the nude, you know? And Roger's probably gone, yeah, oh, good idea. Hey, boys, what about take? Oh, okay, we're able to take it. And we had no qualms about it, you know, except you didn't want your elbow on someone's parts, you know, sort of.
No.
No.
You wanted to make sure you were placed.
Oh, God, yeah.
Nicely. Splash it on, little girl. And everyone
it touches is refreshed. Touch me when my head's on fire. And there was another ad that we did, 4711.
Yeah,
Ice Cologne.
Ice Cologne, yeah.
That's where Roger was so good for us. He had a mindset of what to do, you know, it was great.
Davies managed Sherbet from the beginning of their careers. He has since worked with Cher, Tina Turner, and is now Pink's manager. I've been riding love songs since we broke up. And it was Pink that Daryl's latest single was originally written for. One of Daryl's mates asked him to pass it on to Roger.
I had to listen to it and I thought, my God, that's a good song. I sent it off to Roger on my phone, which I'm not very good at that, but about a month went by and I thought, I haven't heard from Roger, so I think we might start playing it. And then I said to him over lunch, did you like that song that I sent you? He said, what song? No, I didn't want to let it die. I was praying that you leave the light on. I blamed my phone. So he had a listen to it and he said, no, I think it suits you more than Pink. And I went,
God for that.
Okay, thanks, Rod. He's always been a good friend, though. He has. And I know in my life
there is only one you. Do you remember when you sang your first love song to someone you were in love with? Like, was it, for instance, Olivia Newton-John, your girlfriend at school when you were 12?
Olivia, God, yes.
Did you ever sing her a love song?
We held hands for a little while when we were 11 or 12 at Christchurch Grammar School there, but I don't think I ever sang to her. But over the last couple of months, I've been emailing her and I asked her where she was for a photo that somebody had sent to me. It said, we backed Olivia Newton-John at Embers or something in Toorak Road, South Yarra. So I sent it to her. She said, oh, yeah, I remember that place, but I don't know about the band. And that's when I said to her, I didn't even know that you could sing at school. And
oh,
she said, Oh, no, well, it was after that, Daryl, that I went on. I said, oh, yeah, I know. You went on.
Pretty familiar with that bit.
Yeah, exactly.
Your voice, your amazing bloody voice. We heard you at Firefight in front of that amazing crowd.
Yep.
It's still exactly as it was in the 70s. What is your secret? What do you do to look after your voice? Do you have secret potions?
No. I'm probably as paranoid as the next person. Like, who can I bring up? James Rain, my good friend.
Yeah, you're our mate, yeah.
I do sometimes get a little concerned with it because you sing and you think, and then you get in and you think, oh, it's all right. And then for some unknown reason, it'll sort of start to wobble. So you look after it more, I think, or it becomes, you know, a bit broken.
In 1991, Daryl found himself on top of the charts again with his cover of Ricky Lee Jones' The Horses. Way up in the sky, little darling. The song has been called an alternative national anthem.
I don't know why it's so endearing to people. For different reasons, I'm sure, but probably never find out. I mean, it's just one of those songs.
Are you still surprised by the reaction you get to it sometimes, like at Falls Festival stuff? Yeah, because it's just through every generation.
Yeah, and it's not as though I've gone out there and tried to promote it and make it bigger and better. The band and I, over the last, what's it been out, nearly 30 years, just played it the same. It does have the enthusiasm from the band and I when we play it that we're hoping for that reaction. If we didn't get that reaction, then I'd have a psychological breakdown.
Would you?
Oh, what's wrong? It's over. I'll stop now. Okay. I need the room to get
out of the gloom into the slipstream. Before we wrap up, it's something I feel I need to apologise for again. This is at the peak, your peak Sherbet. Right. And my babysitter had found out where you were staying in Sydney at one stage. And I charged my schoolgirls in my class 20 cents. We were 10 and showed them where you were staying because you'd sometimes be in the front garden, sometimes doing a bit of...
Where was this
Tai Chi? In Clifton Gardens.
I had a girlfriend there, yes.
So if you saw a whole lot of little schoolgirls, about 10, in their uniforms, that
That's
was me.
All right.
I made some good dosh, which I invested in Easter show bags, very wisely, so I hope you're okay with that. But it's a terrible invasion of privacy. It was a
Clifton
shocking
Gardens.
Thing.
I thought I kept that really secret. Should have. I've been riding around.